joy. No matter what we left, who we left, how we left, we are standing here today with joy because we are in the house of the Lord. And Father, while we're in your house to worship and praise you, I have my joyfully people, Father, for what good is our coming together without you, Father. So I'm so thankful, as the psalmist said, that we ought to make noise and joyful noise in that unto the Lord, for you are worthy of it. You have done marvelous things. You continue to show yourself strong. You continue to take us from the mountain to the valley, from the valley to the mountain, and you show power demonstrated on the mountain. You show power in the valley, and my God, that we need it. We thank you today for every expression of power that you are willing to show us. We're thankful for your rod and your staff that covered us. We are so thankful, Lord, that we can come and, as the writer said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in your house than to dwell in the tents of wicked. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you have delivered us and brought us from wherever and however, and by your grace and your kindness, Lord, we stand here today. And we are thankful. Have your way. Minister to these your people, those, Father, who are lost, let them find their way. Let the gospel go forth and let it be preached everywhere. Those who have joined the mission field to go out and declare your great name, Father, I pray for resources. I pray for supernatural intervention, Lord, that the gospel might have free course in the hearts of those who are far from the peaceful shore. Bring them in, Father, by your power and by your glory. Let the orator speak that of the mercy and power of God. Let those who minister stand between the altar and the people and minister your word faithfully, Father. Raise up a generation, Father, that even now would know that you are the sovereign God and that you rule and reign.
Thank you.
don't sing no more because they're not theologically sound. But this song is sound theologically. God is faithful. And we need to remind ourselves He can do it again and again and again. And I'm so glad we serve that kind of God, because I need Him to do it again. And guess what, y'all? It's not exactly the same thing. I got another thing I need Him to do again. What I need Him to do again, I need Him to make a way. He made a way out of this. He makes a way out of that. He brought me through this. He prayed for me through that.
Trusting God for it, I believe, all my heart. Pray for
what a trial looks like. You might not know, Jesus went through six trials, six different moments of standing before those who would falsely accuse him. This is all about the way of the Calvary, the cross. It makes what we celebrate and understand as the crucified Savior, it makes the meaning of it all that much more to know what he went through. So I'm studying and reading and looking at what the Romans' trial was like and what the Israelites' trial was. If you notice the statement is made, he said, you go in judgment according to your law. Don't look at that and understand what their law was and why they wanted to go beyond what they were entitled to as operating within the confines of a government, but they were governed by an overseeing government, the Roman government. So there was limits. There was certain stipulations that fed into that. So we're going to look at that, Lord willing, on Wednesday. We want to pray. Certainly is a time for prayer, isn't it? War is about to break out. Is it evident? War is about to break out. And while nations are mounting up for war, you're dealing with your own little battles, ain't you?
Amen.
I am too.
Amen.
There's war in my house. There's war in my life. And I believe God is going to give us victory. The Bible says let your request be made known. God will never move until you invite him into. I shared with a brother one time, I said, man, you know, as a pastor and just dealing with people, I've learned, unless I'm invited into a situation, I don't get involved. I let people, the Bible says, if any sick, let them call for the elders of the church. And if a situation is going on in the lives of people, everybody deal with things differently. But I don't invade. If it's drawn into just them, I leave that alone. But I'm invited in and I come in prayerfully, gracefully, humbly, compassionately, and all of the things that involve that of a person who care, because we certainly do care about the needs of people, and many, as they have called and shared their life and issues and things going on, you never see me walk away without saying, let's pray. Let's talk to God about it, because it's okay. I mean, it's great touching and agree with someone in the earth, and we need that. But oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sin and griefs to bear. Oh, what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Amen.
I cannot go through the amount of scripture that encourages us to come. And one writer said, come boldly.
Yes.
Come boldly to the throne.
Yes.
Come with an anticipation that God can and will. Come with the grace that know you have been permitted, even though you might be sinful, you might be in a situation you need God to wash you up. But he said, you can come. And I love the way Isaiah put it. He said, come, let's reason together. God will reason with you. Wherever you are, he's willing to reason with you. He's willing to help you. Apostle John, the apostle of love, says that if we come and if we are willing to confess, he's faithful. If you're willing to confess, he's faithful. Nowhere in the scripture do you see God turn down genuine repentance. A repentant heart. The Bible said that sacrifice that God loved is a broken and contrite heart that he won't despise, he won't turn away from. You can be a millionaire giver. Somebody would appreciate that and benefit from it. But if your heart is not right, you just gave something. The true sacrifice is a broken and contrite heart. What happened to the brokenness that used to invade the walls of our churches? Let's get back to brokenness. Let's get back to travail and calling on God, because he's the only one that can fix your situation. He's the only one that can regulate the mind of those who have lost their way. He is the only one that can bring the realities of your life back to where they need to be. He is the only one that can reach your child. Our sons and our daughters need our prayer. They need your money, but yes, they need your prayer more than that. Yes, they need you to intervene, but they need your prayer. Don't get up off the altar.
Yes.
I'm praying for mine. You say they all want you. You just already was lifting up prayer. Noah was praying. I'm not going to stop praying. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray about you, for you, with you. We're going to bombard heaven together. Your need might not be the same as the person sitting next to you, but guess what? All of us have our needs. And we need God to move. We need God to work it out. You're married, you need God. You're single, you need God. If you're a parent, you need God. Don't you tell me you don't. You do. You're a grandmother, you need God. And folks, when they move and get far away from us, my mother-in-law was right. They are more heavier on our heart than they were when we weighed 8 pounds, 6 pounds, and we were carrying them. And if God don't intervene, that break, that heaviness will break you down. You know it will. This is why we come to this time of prayer, and we don't try to rush through it. We don't try to just fill up a bunch of words just so we can say we pray. We are in need of the Savior. We need the Master's touch. And as we come now, I know in this room, we have our needs, and we're connected with people who have needs. So we must approach this time looking to our God. Join me as we pray. We're praying. We're calling on the one who can fix the reality of our situation. God, as we look to you, the author and finisher of our faith, Father, we call on you. Help us, O God. Lord, we need your help. We need your power. We need you to intervene. Save our children. Save husbands and wives, grandchildren, sisters and brothers. Restore to health. Restore that which the enemy has masterfully robbed so many of. So many have lost their joy. Can't remember the last time they really felt the joy of the Lord. Father, I pray for restoration. I pray for revival. Lord, while we are on the brink of seeing war, your word is being fulfilled right before our very eyes. And our eyes are upon you and your word. Help us to get it right. Help us to stand in this evil day as an example of your glory. The glory of a changed life. The glory of a life that you brought out of sin. A life that you took out of darkness into the marvelous light. Father, I pray, Lord, for the wisdom of your word. I thank you for man's wisdom. I thank you for the intellect by which we've been able to succeed in life and go somewhere. But oh God, far above any of that, we need your wisdom. We need your word. That which makes the simple wise. That which makes the starving heart to be satisfied. We need bread from heaven. Draw us. Draw us to that place. Draw us to that place in you. And Father, we'll be so careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, because it is yours. You have been so good to us. You have provided. Some of us live in homes, cars, clothes, more than one change of clothes, food, refrigerators full, baskets are full. We have a job of sustaining power to us, Lord. You have been good to us. You kept us with our right mind, that portion of health and strength, Lord. Somebody woke up today and things were not the same. Somebody reality changed severely today. And yet here we are at this moment. And you are keeping us. You're all over keeping us alive, keeping us to thrive in 2022. And most of all, Lord, give us a clear vision to see and know your word and stand on it. So, Father, as we cry out, Father, we ask for revival. We ask, Father, for more than a week of meetings. We ask for more than that which just makes us feel good. We ask for more than that which makes us buy a CD and a tape. Father, we ask for that which goes deep down on the inside and changes us. Father, I pray. I don't know how much more time I have to minister to the hearts of these your people in this room. Young people who might decide tomorrow, I'm done with church. Father, while we have this moment, I pray for a fresh anointing, and I pray that the reality of truth, that heaven and hell exist, will become a real reality in the lives of our young people today. That is our burden, Lord. That is our passion. And they don't just sit here and grow up and out of the church, but they will grow in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, my prayer is that none be lost. None will choose to go to the world as opposed to the church. And I pray, Father, that you would hedge them about. The enemy has a plan, but we stand in the gap against that plan. We prophesy to you, Father, you will be righteous. You will be the holiness of God that will represent the Lord in the earth when we are long gone. That you will be a generation like Daniel that will declare his truth. We decree and declare, Father, the clarion call over their life. Arrest them, Father. Let the hounds of heaven, Lord, interrupt all of their peace until they come to the Prince of Peace and surrender the crown, hallelujah, of their life to you. Thank you. Thank you for you all. Faithful God.
Keep my commandments and choose the things that please me
and take hold of my covenant. Even unto them will I give in my house and within my walls a place, a name better than sons and daughters. Wow. I will give them a everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Verse 6, it says, and also the sons of the stranger that joined themselves to the Lord to serve him and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants. Everyone that keeps the Sabbath from polluting it and taking hold of my covenant, even them that I bring to my holy mountain and make them, say, joyful.
Joyful.
Joyful in the house, in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all
people. Yes, Lord.
Give us ears to hear, heart to receive, and mind to react. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Please be seated and let's ride this train.
All right.
Isaiah, he's that known prophet. His book is pretty large. It's full of insight, prophecy, warnings, promises that God showed. Our life is a series of choices. Choices we make. You made the choice to come here. You made the choice to look and listen. You made that choice. You made that choice based on a series of reasons, but you made the choice. Nothing will prompt a person to make godly right choices more than the gospel preaching that exposes sin and draws us into the fold. In Isaiah 56 and 4, beginning of our text, Isaiah is making sure you know I'm not talking here. This is what the Lord is giving you to say. The eunuchs, those who are set aside, that keep my holy day, that was Sabbath to me. It represents the person who has chosen the Christian life as the basis by which they will live my life, their life. He said, to that one that keeps my Sabbath. Now, in the old days, to keep the Sabbath was ritualistically strenuous. There were things you could and could not do in order to properly celebrate the Sabbath.
Amen.
By sundown, Friday, you were shut in. You were going into a mode of preparation because the Sabbath day was holy unto the Lord. In the days of old, if you read the book of Leviticus, to break the Sabbath was a serious offense.
Yes.
The Lord said here through Isaiah, the one that do keep my Sabbath and choose those things, and if you don't mind writing in your Bible or highlighting or making a mental note, those things that please me. When does it matter, this business of God's pleasure? When does it ever come into focus? It's when you choose to make it a priority. When does it matter that it's pleasing to God? When you choose to. No wonder it's all centered around, somebody said, choice.
Sure.
That's why the writer said, choose this day who you're going to serve. When you make that choice, there's certain things that follow with that choice, right?
Yeah.
That's what we say, I have decided to follow Jesus. Being I put aside from something. So when this business of God's pleasure comes to be our pleasure, how can we please him outside of his word? Somebody say you can't do it.
Come
on, say it again. You can't do it. That's why we got to present the gospel and present it right. This is why we have no time for juvenile church. Juvenile church is taking over the land now. A bunch of spiritual juveniles, unsettled in the word, immature in the handling of the word, preaching milk messages for first grade church. Children's church is now taking the main auditorium. And because now we're in children's church, we're producing children instead of growing into mature sons and daughters.
Amen.
And this is what God is after. Maturity. Growth. This business of pleasing God certainly entails that you grow. This is why the word is so important. We find that God uses it to draw Bible says he has to take hold. That word hold in the Hebrew means to grasp and not let go. I grab this and I won't let go. I got a hold on it. And when you grab the word and you refuse to let go, when you take a hold on it, it becomes to consume and change you. That's why the writer said, the word I hid in my heart. That's truly taking hold of it. The promises to such a one in verse 5 of the text, he said, even to them, somebody say it goes further. He said, even to them will I give in my house. Those that are already in the house within my walls, do you not know what the benefit of it is? There's some weather going on outside that we're not experiencing because we're protected by four walls.
Yeah.
And because we're in this structure, we feel the reflection of safety from being walled in. I'm going somewhere. I'm walled in, and because I'm here, he said, even unto them I will give in my house. Now, I'm going to address those outside the house, but trust you me, there are some words that need to go down to those in the house. Look at somebody tell them, I need a word if I'm in this house. I don't need to know about your boat, your car, I don't need to know about your shoes, but forget about your tie. I need a word in this house. I need something in this house that's going to help me go to my house and be able to bring him some glory. Give you a name. did. As many, whoever, received him through gospel preaching. He said, to them he gave power. No wonder you get a name that's everlasting. No wonder you get all that stuff we were just looking at in Isaiah. He gives you power. He gives you power in and of your own self you don't have. And Lord knows you know you need power. Every other sentence is a lie. Sometimes you don't want to ask people some things if you don't want them to lie. He gives you power to stop doing that. He gives you power to be real, and in the reality of that realness, you are faithful to him. He said, as many as receive him, to them he give power. Now look, if you receive Christ and you let Christ come in and do a work in your life, he will give you some power. Well, folks was adamant about that, boy. If you couldn't demonstrate you had no power, they didn't trust the validity of your claim of salvation. So they wanted to see you come out of the bar, put down the marijuana, put down the cigarettes. They wanted to see you give up the girlfriend. They wanted to see you give up the booze. They wanted to see these signs that follow believers coming out of the world and being separate. If you don't have that kind of power, then you need to go to God and ask him for it. Because if you receive him, he will give you power, much needed power. There's gave again. That didn't say bye. He said he gave them power. Folks, he took all of the work out of it for us. No wonder there's a joy of our salvation. He gives us what we need in order to be for him what we need to be. This is a wonderful illustration of the church. God bring those who make the choice to a place in his house and make the name that cannot be taken away. John, who lived a long time, he was the oldest of the apostles to live. Wasn't by choice of men, but they tried to kill him. All of them beat him, he wouldn't die. So they put him out on Patmos. When he wrote 1 John 3:1, he was more of an aged man. This is why we look at him as the apostle of love. He said, behold, look at this, y'all. Look at this with me. What manner of love is this? What is this? What kind of love is this? Now, I've experienced love on all kinds of levels, but not like this. What manner of love? This is the kind of love that is astounding. Theologically, it blows our mind. What manner of love is this that he has bestowed? There's a freedom there. There's no price paid on that. He just put it on us. Somebody said, put it on me, Lord. Yeah, he just put it on us, man. He said he bestowed upon us that we, an ex-crack addict, an ex-thief, an ex-robber, homie, you fill in the gap wherever you need to fill it at. What kind of love is this that he has bestowed upon us that we should be called? I don't even deserve to be called by it, y'all, but he gave it to me anyway, and I'm so glad he did. He called us sons of God. Sons of the living God. John said, what kind of love is this? This messed me up, so I gotta let it mess you up a little bit. Just a little bit, please. What kind of love is this? What kind of love is this that he's bestowed upon us? He put it on us that we should be called kalebos, sons of God. One writer said, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know. Wow, that's astounding. The theologians are baffled and still spend hours trying to communicate this verse to people. I'm doing my best as I can now. Because the word behold is that we must look at this and examine it. That's what it means to behold. Look and examine. Look at what we have here, y'all. Let's don't rush through this. Please give me an extra 2 minutes if I need it at least. But I don't want to just do this to get justice of just running by. Behold, let's look at this. This is the manner in the Greek. It means a kind of method, a methodology in and of ourselves we're not used to. You know how it is. I'm used to part-timers. Love me for a season and then go. I'm used to overnight quickies, you know.
Yeah.
Gone.
Gone.
In the day, gone tomorrow.
Mm.
I'm used to my heart being broke.
Mm.
I'm used to men standing up saying, I love you, and then all of a sudden they're gone, you know. By the same time he sold you, daddy told three other girls the same thing. You know, what manner of love is this that sticks?
Mm.
This is what the writer is saying, and this is the kind of love that sticks. No wonder he said, I give you everlasting. My Lord, this is good. He said, this is the kind of love the Father has put on us. Oh my God, he put it on me. God put it on me.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
This is the kind blows my mind. This is the kind that makes me want to dress up for him.
All right.
When I was in here.
Yes.
What kind of love? What manner of love is this?
Mm.
The old saints used to sing, love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. How'd that verse go? I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore of the master. I need a little help here today. The master of the sea. Church and around the church. That's kind of a manipulation and sense, but there is a sense of service that ought to include your gifting and talents being made available for the youth, that if it would help the local church and the church function, if you have a particular gift and talent. But that comes because of your love. There's the next phrase. Love the name of the Lord. I got it here. I did things that pastors don't do. Why? I love God and I love his house.
Amen.
I'm not above anything in here.
Amen.
And you ought not be above anything, because I love God. I will stoop to whatever level is needed. I can clean the bathrooms. I know how to do it. Don't I, Juan? Don't say nothing. I ain't above nothing. I'll cook, clean, all of that. Serve because of love. And look what he said. To be his plural. Servants. Everyone. Everyone that claimed this must do it without polluting his name. And then there's that key verse. Take hold. Because you can't do it without a sense of understanding his word. He promises a place for even a stranger who joined to the Lord and served as the key. And in our day, we seem to have to do everything. Nobody wants to serve. I've never seen such nonsense. People that can... Now, I understand you're not a musician or a singer or something, but there's a capacity to serve and show and bring forth,
yes,
to enter you out.
Yes.
God promises a place for even a stranger, and serve is the key. We seem to have what serving the Lord entails embodied into a ritual. And in Psalm 102, the Bible says, serving with gladness.
Yes.
Serving with gladness. Man, I'm glad about what I'm doing here, man. I'm on the mountain, man. I feel good. I'm in my zone. This is me. Service is not a problem. I don't mind helping give a ride, clean the floor, whatever. I mean, to serve people is a joy to me.
Yes.
Serve the Lord. And the Bible says you do it with gladness. Come before his presence. Not mad and dragging. I look at some and I think, wonder what happened to you. Some of y'all come in here and I look at you and I think, what happened? My Lord, you are alive. That's enough to be jumping right there.
Yes.
I tell people at work, they ask me how I'm doing. I'm doing great. I woke up this morning. We can figure the rest of it out.
Amen.
Come on. You can figure it out. God woke you up this morning. Anything else can be negotiated. It's a matter of choice. The roof can fall in. Yes, the reality of that does change things, but you don't have to let it consume you.
Yeah.
That old song said, hallelujah, anyhow. Never let your troubles get you down. When you come on, people, go your way. Come on, you just can sing it. Hallelujah, anyhow. Some people have lost their hallelujah anyhow.
Yeah.
They got their hallelujah long as they got a dollar in their pocket, long as they got their rent paid, long as they got a car. David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than in the well of the tents of the wicked. That's why he said, I was glad when they said unto me, let's go.
Let's go.
Let's go, let's go, let's go.
Yeah.
Come on.
Serve. Self-serving will never open up to the bigger picture.
Mm.
When you're self-serving, it's closed in, because it's all about me, myself, or there's a third one, I.
Right.
You got to get delivered from that.
Yeah.
And then when you do, you find the heart of God with a joy in serving. Mm. Even when you want to quit, you still find yourself serving, because you can. When you get to can't help us, he got you.
Right.
I can't help it. I can't help praising his name. I just can't help praising his name. Our major text is in verse 7. Isaiah said, is this good? He said, even them, who? Them strangers. glad you bothered me. Me too, brother. He said, even them I bring to my holy mountain.
Yes.
Now, Veron Ash helped me understand this in another message about dogs. Mountain represents heights.
Yes.
And God will bring us, as the word example brings in Judah, heights of holiness. Remember that? He brings us to heights of holiness. No wonder. He said, when I bring them, I'm going to bring them to my holy mountain. I'm going to bring them to a place far above that which they were. If I don't bring them to a place higher than that, they ain't going to have no need of me. What good is I'm going to stay the same way? Why should I come to God when I'm still going to be a drug addict? Why do I come to God and I'm still drinking the alcohol and still going through? Why do I come to God and I'm still jacked up from the throw up? He said, I'm going to bring them to my holy mountain. I'm going to bring them to a place so high up, they're going to forget about cocaine. They're going to forget about alcohol. I'm going to bring them to a place that they never thought they can get to. He said, I'm going to bring them, and if I got to bring them out of hell, I'm going to bring them out. If I got to get them out of divorce, I'm going to bring them out. If I got to bring them out of the gutter, I'm going to bring them out. If I got to bring them from the low of the lows, I'll bring them out. If I got to bust them out of jail, I'll bring them out. If I got to make the way out of the way, I'm going to bring them out. Some of y'all are sitting here today because God brought you. He brought you out of this to bring you to that. And because he put you in a place up above him, you realize now it had not been the Lord that was on my side. What would I be? He brought me to write and say, up. Somebody have a up. He brought me up out of a horrible thing. He brought me from a place they told me I couldn't come back from. He brought me.
Thank you.
Even them, I'll bring them. Even them. Yeah. See, why you're trying to look past them?
Yeah.
God looking right at them.
Yeah.
Why you think they'll never make it? God looking right at them.
Come on, man.
And the truth be told, you was one of them. And truth be told, I was one of them. And I'm so glad. I'm so glad the Lord chose me. He brought us in. I'm so glad, my sister. I was one of them. Seeking deacons in. Far from the peace of God. I ain't no one PC, but I got it now. 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 I got it now.
Like this.
The Lord will perform that. my Savior, He's working it out for me. Watch this now. It won't always be like this. Somebody need to hear that. It won't always. That's why you hold on. I'm hurting, but I'm yet singing. It's trouble on every side, but yet there's a joy. Solomon put it this way. He said, I am the rose of Sharon.
Yes.
Said in Solomon 2:1, I am the lily of the valley. Nothing looks more pretty than when you see that hillside. This is the picture he paints.
Yeah.
With all those thorns and thistles and trees,
uh-huh.
The beautiful lilies just stand out. The beautiful lilies just stand out. Folks, that is a prophecy of what the world looked like when people like you, with the glory of God, are planted in segments of it. You're planted around thorns and thistles, but you shine as a lily because I am the rose.
Yeah.
Sharon. He said, the apple tree among the trees of the wood, just like an apple tree is so beautiful, because it possessed that sweet fruit. He said, so is my beloved. I took a seat. You know, nothing in the heat of the day is more promising and joyful than getting up under a shade tree. You don't know about that. I know y'all run to your air conditioning, but before you get to the air conditioning, you get under a shade tree. And even though it's scorching hot under that tree, you're protected from the heat. The writer says, look, I sat down there. This is a good place to sit. This is a good place to take camp, y'all, in the house of the Lord. This is the picture that Solomon is writing here. He said, I sat down under his shadow with great delight. There's a joy in salvation that makes you happy. Because over on the Lord's side, I feel churchy for some reason. Over on the Lord's side makes me happy, makes me mighty glad. He said, I had a delight because his fruit was sweet to my taste. I don't know about you, but when I get a taste of something good, I don't just stop at a taste. I make sure I get to a table where it's at. Some of y'all have been to the restaurant, so they know you by your first name. Something tastes good up in there. Come on, y'all.
Yes.
Some of y'all open your Bible, the Lord said, oh, there you go, go into Psalms. Why? It tastes good.
Good.
Tastes good.
Yeah.
It's got all that stuff on it that I like. Blessed is the man that walk in the counsel of the godly. Don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. He said, he'll be like a tree, but it tastes good.
Yeah, yeah.
It tastes good. Lord, are they increased that trouble? Many are they that rise up against me. Many are they that say in my soul, there is no help for him in God. See, life, it tastes good.
Yeah.
Have mercy on me, oh God, according to thy loving kindness. It tastes good.
Yeah.
I can't help it. I want to sit at the table. It's good. It's good. I've never stopped finding good stuff to eat in here. Oh, it tastes good. Wherewith shall a young man cleanse his ways by taking heed according to it? It tastes good. The writer said it tastes so good. Yeah. some things my wife cooked that was so good, she had to slow me down.
Gather the outcast. Yet will
besides those that are gathered in. So heart to heart, I love you. You know I do. But there's some others God want to bring in here. And you are the connection to them.
Yeah.
You can't be scared of this virus. You can't be scared of what the world is doing. We have to get them in. They don't need to come to hear me. They need to come and get saved and give their life to the Lord. They don't need to come in here for any other purpose than that.
Yes.
And Lord knows that's our purpose here.
Yes.
I'm not on an ego trip, but I'm telling you, this is not all God wanted St. Augustine here in the gospel.
Right.
This is not all God wanted. There's seats for the people that God will bring in. Others are out there. Others are on your job. They're in your phone. If everybody in here could get 5 of your contacts to come to church next Sunday, this place could hold them. No, you want to talk to them about sewing and knitting and fishing and going somewhere to the park or somewhere. You good enough to fish with? You good enough to serve the Lord with? You good enough to go on a date? You good enough to go know about your God? If she don't want to know about your God, red flag. He don't want to know about your God, red flag. Run! Don't look back.
Amen.
You better. He might not even be leaving. He always had us in mind. He always had us in mind. Close with one more passage. I know I've done a bit of reading here, but I want you to understand something. In Isaiah 12:1, he said, that day thou shalt say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Though thou was angry with me, your anger is turned away, and thou comfortest me. Behold, this is what we look at and examine. God is my salvation. Somebody said, the joy of my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid for the Lord Jehovah. Now you notice the writers got excited and felt a little bit of the Holy Ghost jitters because they made that all caps, rightfully so. The Lord Jehovah. The all-knowing, all-seeing, all-sufficient one is my strength. Look at the strength you have now. That takes your strength out of the equation. Somebody says, so glad.
So glad.
I'm limited.
Yeah.
I give out quick. But he has what lasts. He has become my salvation. Therefore, with joy, we draw water from the wells of salvation. There's no way we should come to church and not have a good time. I'm not talking about somebody falling out all the time, somebody jumping, but I'm talking about a joy that maintains the house. A joy of salvation. We come with joy to draw. Are you glad you draw today? Are you glad you brought empty pictures today? You get full and now go back to the realities of what you got to face, but I go back different. I came in one way, but I leave another. By God's grace, one more time, I have something to reflect on. And I go out of here prepared for what I will be faced over there. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer. That's my cry. Lord, make this church, make these your people, a house of prayer where we will go up on the mountain and pray. Go up on the mountain and call on him and with joy draw water. Nothing more sustaining to our life than a drink of cold water. Refreshing water. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house with prayer. Let the fire of my altar never go out. Somebody say never.
Never.
I don't ever want it to go out. We're going to pray. And I don't want you to just listen to me. We're going to talk to God for a moment. We are in the battle. And the battle is not ours. It's the Lord's. make me a house of prayer. Make us in this generation a people ready, a people that will stand. Make us pillars, pillars fortified, strong, powerful. Oh, yes. Make us one more time. Oh, God, make us, Father, as we respond to your word. Come to this time of prayer. Father, I pray, Lord, for your people. I pray, Lord, that you would encourage and strengthen, renew, restore. Father, maybe someone here would say, I've lost my joy, the joy of my salvation. I lost it, and I'm sorry, God, but if you would just give me that right mind, Lord, I choose, Lord, to rejoice in you, Lord. I choose not to let my problems overtake me again. I'm sorry, Lord, for becoming cold and indifferent, Lord. But, oh, God, if you would, Lord, please restore to me the joy of my salvation, Lord, and uphold that right spirit in me, Lord, and renew the right spirit in me, Lord. Create in us clean hearts, Lord. Right spirit in us. Oh, 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 do it one more time, Lord. We pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would fire us up, Lord, with a fresh fire, a fresh anointing. We really need you, God. Can't do nothing without you, Lord. We need your wisdom. We need your guidance. We need your strength. to stand. The glory of the Lord is in this room. You stand right now in your valley, and we're going to plead your case before our God. We're going to plead your cause. Hallelujah. Everything they faced wasn't always pleasant. But they had the joy of their salvation that pushed them through it all. And you, my friend, God will give you that same joy so that you can go through it all, trusting in Jesus. When we come to this time, we come out of a sense of responsibility that we must understand it's not cheap grace. Communion is nothing about just something we do on the first Sunday or any Sunday. It's realizing whose we are and how we must live in life then. We come to the Lord's table realizing what was done for us. He paid a debt he didn't even owe. You and I owe a debt we can never pay. Thank God he washed us. As we come to this time to the Lord's table and celebrate and remember what has been done, what we must do in light of what has been done. We are thankful. Brothers are coming. It's going to pass out. You're welcome to share with us in this time of reflection. Because it is so symbolically important. Paul wrote a letter to the church of Corinth because they were misappropriated. They were not celebrating rightly. And he said, look, I had to set this in order. Can't let this go without doing so. He said, a couple of lessons that we are to take. It's not to be taken in any ill manner. We are to remember that he surrendered willfully to all of that punishment, subjugated himself so that you and I can have life, abundant life. So as we take the bread, I always tell you before we eat this together, we break it as a symbol of the brokenness that we call upon. I pray that you desire to be broken so that you can be used for his purpose. Brokenness, the important thing. Paul said on the same night in which the Lord was betrayed, he took bread and broke it. He said, take heed, this is my body. Our bodies is for the purpose of God. We are to use it, present it as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is a reasonable service. I'm going to pray. And I need to pray, and we're going to take this together, but we're going to break it as a sign and a reflection of the brokenness that we acknowledge that we must come to so that God can use us. Father, I thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your Bible that was shed for us. Father, I pray, Lord, that as we take this bread, Father, I pray, Lord, that we would take it out of the sense of willingness to be broken. Broken of our passions and our dreams for yours. It's a good trade-off. Let us be reminded as we take this of the awesomeness of the price you paid for us, for which we are thankful, and we receive it with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible said on the same night he took the cup, a cup whole substance. Cup has to be free of leaks and cracks so that it can hold that substance. God wants to fill you with a substance that he can pour out into the earth. You know, scholars often say they baffle at how could there still be blood in the body of Jesus after all of that torture and pain and whipping. And yet when they pierced him in his side, blood and water came out—that which reconnects us to Him. And I say, well, but not for the shed of blood, there would be no removal of sins. And thank God, that which a goat couldn't do, a lamb couldn't do, the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world, freely did for us. As we receive this, I pray that you pray to be an offering poured out in our generation. Father, I thank you for your shed blood. I thank you for this first Sunday time that we have this time together to celebrate this meal and to reflect on how this is an important thing to us. That you who knew no sin became sin, that we might be the righteousness of God. Oh, the joy of our salvation. We thank you and we receive it with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. Thank you.